Hi and welcome to this masterclass. My name is Abdi Mohiddin and I'm a public health physician working with the Aga Khan University and part of the Lancet Small Vulnerable Newborn series.
Thanks for joining us. Welcome to this masterclass. My name is Eric Ohuma. I'm an associate professor of medical statistics at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine.
We'll be talking about the Lancet Small and Vulnerable Newborn series, which started about 2 years ago. When the Lancet invited a group of institutions to write about this new concept. So the series is made up of four papers and a commentary. So the first paper looks at the case, making this case for this new concept of the small and vulnerable newborn, bringing in together newer learning into this new concept. Some of the definitions around vulnerability have not changed in over 100 years, so it's time to relook at this and get this new concept to understand better so that we can measure and manage these vulnerable newborns better. The second paper makes a case in terms of the epidemiology and the patterns of disease and where that disease may be. The third paper looks at the biological mechanisms that underpin some of the small and vulnerable newborns. And the fourth paper looks at the interventions that could be used to reduce and mitigate the burden of small and vulnerable newborns. And then the final commentary lists a call for action.
This is an exciting series, and coming from a statistics background, I think the idea that for so many years in the last century we've been focusing on indicators that are more binary, especially low birth weight, I think this series really pushes kind of the narrative forward, but really thinking about ways in how we can better classify newborns. So the idea that we can actually classify newborns belonging to, say, a preterm, and small for gestational age categories, I think is really pushing the narrative. With available information on gestational age, we are able to not just classify newborns based on indicators that have been we've been using for the last century, for example, low birth weight or preterm. We know that lots of newborns actually present with combinations of either being low birth weight or preterm, or some sort of smallness, which is defined as small for gestational age. So I think being able to really understand the kind of vulnerability that these newborns present with and how that relates to burden, especially in terms of mortality, is a really key push in this field. And I think linking that to some of the interventions that have been shown to work in this particular space would help inform even more targeted interventions for specific newborn groups. I'm very pleased that some of the work we've been involved in developing international standards really helps us to be able to put this on the map, being able to get countries using a common set of standards, being able to make comparisons, being able to track the data and trends over time, and really putting that across some of the sustainable development goals targets that we have.
Thank you. So I'll just talk a bit about the proven interventions. So paper four did a look at the literature to identify what interventions exist, and a list of about eight came up. So of this eight, there are three that all pregnant women should be getting. I'll just list those for you now. Multiple micronutrient supplements, smoking cessation education, screening and treating for bacteriuria. Then there's several other interventions that are more context or target group specific, and these are low dose aspirin, energy protein supplementation, malaria and bed nets treatment and prevention, and progesterone vaginally, and the final one is screening and treating syphilis. So these proven interventions can be used within the context of existing antenatal care guidelines that the World Health Organization has. The final commentary makes a call for action based on three pillars. And the first pillar is saying, well, we need to make small and vulnerable newborn prevention a priority. It's been neglected for a while, and we need to revisit that. The second pillar is saying, well, what we need to do is get these proven interventions scaled up and used globally and into existing guidelines. So WHO, the World Health Organization, already has some guidelines. We need to incorporate these new interventions. And then the third pillar is around improving our measurement and accountability. And within the series, we're careful to note that there are things that can be done nationally. Countries have a responsibility, and also internationally to support with funding, for example, and technical guidance. And then the final thing we say in the series is around wider societal involvement. It goes beyond just the usual health sector actors. We'd like to get more interest from wider society and really build a bit of a movement around this.
To be able to do this, we need the right data. And some of the work we've done clearly shows that we've had no progress in terms of improving trends for low birth weight in the last 20 years. We've had no progress in reducing preterm birth in the last 10 years. We don't have data for small for gestational age, with only availability of data in very few countries. We need to do better. So for country teams, it's important that we really need to make sure that some of the key ingredients that will help us be able to define the small vulnerable newborns becomes part of routine systems. So these are key data points, which include birth weight, sex, and gestational age. With that availability of data from all countries, from every newborn, we are able to classify the small vulnerable newborns. We are able to track them over time. We are going to be able to get the right interventions and also understand the burdens. So the call for action is we need the right data for every newborn everywhere. I think we can't sit back and wait for 2030. So I think we really need to change the narrative now and not wait for the next 7 years.